Hy's amper blind.
Die Here Jesus Christus gaan jou oë gesond maak. Sodat jy weer kan sien. Wat gebeur? Dankie Jesus. En nou? Wat gebeur? Kan jy my sien?
Ja, ek sien jou.
Is hy al mooi duidelik?
Ja.
Wat wys ek? Wys hom hoe ek hom wys. Alright. Is die mistigheid al beter?
Ja, hy kom beter.
Hy kom beter, né? Ja. Ek dink so. Hè? Huh?
Ja, ek sien.
Jy kan jy al sien?
Ja, ek sien hy
mense. Sien jy daai man daar agter? Kyk hoe wye sy hand, kan jy hom sien? Daar by die muur. Kan jy sien?
Ja, hy twee mense.
Kan jy hulle almal sien?
1 2 3 4. Hy en nie maksimum.
Gesond in die naam van die Here Jesus Christus.
Toe hierdie man ingekom het, toe gryp hy my hand vas en sê, wanneer die tyd is vir gebed, maak net seker ek voorgaan want ek is blind.
What's wrong with her? Come here. Come here, come here, come here. Oosh, oosh. It's hard to get up. Oosh. Would you like Jesus to heal you?
She said the knees. And yes, there's also something here on here.
I see.
That's right.
Tell her. As she looks at me.
And then an epilepsy again.
Tell her she must look at me. Jesus Christ. Tell her, Jesus Christ,
Jesus Christ
is taking all the pain out of your body. Your knees are getting healed. Your body is getting strong. And you will be able to walk.
And then
in Jesus' name. How old are you?
She was born 1914, 89 years.
89 years old. Come, walk in Jesus' name. Trust me. Trust me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Come on. Yeah. Come. Zerech. Hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus. Hey! Thank you, Jesus. There she goes. 89 years old. Yes, uncle, what's fault?
I've got a small heart flutter, which beats now and again differently, not
so
steady.
So butterfly, you know. No.
And my back is also so.
And the back had I seen, yeah. Well, yeah, I feel him, yeah. I feel that thing, yeah. I slam 3 times, miss 1 time. Yeah, I feel him. There goes the uncle. People, I took this man's pulse. It was tick, 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 miss one. tick, 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 miss one. His heart is now tick. Was Wessel, kom voel net die oom se pols dan. This is a medical man.
Daar's geen mis nou nie.
There's nothing. Let's give God some glory in this house. I want you to come. Sit like this. The back problem makes his one leg to be shorter because of the vertebrae that's out. Two hip replacements.
But the left hand one is giving you the problem.
Oh my goodness, now look at that. There Jesus Christ is healing you.
Amen.
Huh? No more pain. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. A perfect heart. That was a miracle.
Amen.
What is it that you need?
Well, they said I had 2 months to live in December because of cancer in my
heart. So you're dead already?
Yes. And then it got a lot worse. And I started to cough very much at the end of February. And I saw you on TV once and Alex thought it'd be a good idea if we came.
Is it your breast? Your chest?
I had breast cancer as well.
Yeah.
10 years. That was a long time ago.
Yeah. And now where did it spread to?
It spread to the lung.
To the lung?
The right lung.
It coughs a lot and it gets very tired. And she can't get a breath. That's what the problem is at the moment.
Thank you, Jesus. Cursed be the cancer. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the Living God. Cursed be the cancer. Let breath now come into these lungs. Let life be this woman's portion. I say to the woman, live and be restored. Be well. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. How does that feel?
Nice breaths.
Hey?
I'm having such wonderful breaths.
Amen.
This woman couldn't breathe. The doctor said she was supposed to be dead in February. Since the end of February, it got worse because of lung cancer. Now she can breathe.
Praise God.
How's those people from Botswana? Who feel you?
Wonderful. I got a total healing.
Absolutely.
I'm breathing deep breaths.
She can breathe and she couldn't breathe because of lung cancer.
Woo!
Come on, say it again.
I got a problem for I'm going to be my sick for both, but still 1990, I'm going to be broken for leg.
You got a broken leg since when?
My accident. 1990. In July 1990.
1990?
Yeah.
That's a long time. It's 13 years.
Yes.
13 years. So it's your cane that? So you walk with it?
Yes.
Show us how you walk. Come, bring your thing. How do you walk? Just walk there. Would you like to be healed? Jesus is making you well. You're going to receive healing for your total body. Your lungs is going to be strengthened.
the muscles in your back and your legs going to be totally restored. Since 1990, 13 years walking with a cane. And tonight the Lord Jesus Christ is setting you free. Come. 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 In Jesus' name. There it goes. 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 Look at this. My goodness. Look, this heel is built up. About 1.5 to 2 centimeters build up, but it's still too short. Would you like to see these legs just healed? In Jesus' name. Be restored. You are healed. Look at that. Did you feel it?
He said the only problem, his leg is shorter than that one.
But now it grew out. No, you must get proper shoes. What size shoe do you wear? Eight. On soek bietjie 8 skoene hierso. Daar's hy. Come on, can you remember how we walked earlier? Wow.
Today's message, Uncondemned Prayer Life.
If you do not forgive, you are not forgiven. When it comes to prayer, the thing that stands in the way is forgiveness. Why is it that people confess? Why is it that they don't get free? You have forgiveness of your sins because of His grace. And if I'm not condemned, whatsoever I ask, I will receive. There is therefore no condemnation. So there, all things that you ask, you get. There, whatsoever you ask, you receive. There, whatsoever you say, you'll have.
Let's join the service now as we listen to this powerful word on Uncondemned Prayer Life.
Isn't it funny how Christians pray their whole life long because it's Christian duties, but they don't get answers to prayer, so why do you pray? I mean, if you don't get an answer to your prayer, why do you pray? I mean, most people pray because they think it's a Christian duty to pray. I don't act it just a duty. It is also a duty. But I don't act it just a duty. I act it as a privilege to go to my Heavenly Father. And yeah, He says in Matthew chapter 7, if I that are evil know how to do good gifts and give good gifts to my children, how much more will my Heavenly Father give if I ask Him?
Yeah.
You see? So I think if I pray, I need to get an answer. If I didn't get an answer, I didn't really pray.
Yeah.
I wasted my breath.
Right.
I wasted my time. And I wasted God's time. Yeah. In 1 Kings chapter 18, when Elijah stood on the mountain with the priests of Baal, this was his prayer. Answer me, O God, answer me.
Yeah.
And the Bible says fire fell from heaven. Now that's answer to prayer.
Hey, hey.
Answer me. Wouldn't you like, you know, if you say, oh God, we need groceries. And the next minute to knock on the door and here stops Pick and Pay themselves. Not somebody bringing something from Pick and Pay. Pick and Pay stop there and say, this is what we got on our shelves. What do you want?
Yes.
You know, something like it. How would you like that? How would you like if you say, oh God, we are in desperate need of 2,000 rand for water and lights tomorrow morning, and while you're still praying, somebody knocks at the door and say, listen, we're just driving past, and when we saw this house, we got an urge to just drop 2,000 rand here. Won't you just like it? But in Mark chapter 11, verse 24 and 25, Jesus says something to the effect, starting at verse 22. He says, you must have faith in God. For whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be cast into the sea, shall have whatsoever he saith. So Jesus says, you can have. You can have whatsoever you say. My goodness. Then in, this is Mark chapter 11. Then in 1 John chapter 3, verse 20 through 22, he says something to the effect. He says, if our heart condemns us, God is greater than our hearts. If our heart condemns us not, then have we boldness towards God. Then verse 22, and whatsoever we ask, we receive of him. If you stand speaking to situations, do you every time get whatsoever you say? And if you pray, do you get whatever you ask of him? Now the Bible does say that. Now is God a liar? Numbers 23:19 says the following. When Balaam was asked of Balak to just curse the children of Israel, and Balaam stood up and he said, God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. Hath he not said, and shall he not do it? Hath he not spoken, and shall it not come to pass? So if God said something, God means it. I mean, God's not a liar. In Romans, the Bible says, let every man be a liar and God be truth. So, in other words, your truth must look like a lie when you look at God. That's how great God's truth is. That when you speak truth, it must look like a lie, man. That's how great God's truth is. So God says, whatsoever you ask, you can have. Did God lie, or are we on the wrong side of the track? Now, let's just look at those two scriptures in depth. Just 1 minute and see if we cannot just pull something out there and see what God wants to say to us today. Amen. Mark chapter 11. Verse 22, Jesus answering them said, have faith in God. For verily I say unto you that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire when you pray, what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. Yes. Come, church. Yes. Verse 25. But when you stand praying, forgive if you ought against any, that your Father also which is in heaven may forgive you your trespasses. Yeah. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father which is in heaven forgive you. Okay. Let's just put that down as something. So if you pray like this, if you pray like that, you must forgive any person that's got anything against you or done anything to you. You must forgive. If you don't, you, let's make it present tense, are not forgiven by God. So when you stand praying, God says forgiveness on your side, I mean your open heart, is a key to get whatsoever you say. You must be forgiven. Forget about that for a moment. You must be forgiven. If you are not forgiven, let's look at 1 John chapter 3. It says in verse 20, for if our heart condemn us, okay, condemnation. So if our heart condemns us, no entry towards our prayer life. If our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart, and God knows everything that stands in your way that makes you feel condemned. If your heart tells you, you stinking rat, you sinner, you ugly, you wicked thing, God knows exactly what is there that you didn't forgive, and God knows exactly what they are that you are not forgiven of. So God is greater than the sin that is condemning you. Because what will condemn you? Sin will condemn you. Is that okay? Verse 21. Beloved, if our heart condemn us not, then we have confidence. If you look at another translation, just on the amplified, then have we boldness. If there's no condemnation, that leads to boldness. Okay? And whatsoever we ask. So if we got boldness, that leads to whatever we ask. Okay. It's boldness that'll take you to a place where whatever you ask, you receive. But boldness only comes when there's no condemnation. No condemnation only comes when you know that you are forgiven and there's nothing between you and your Maker.
Yes, hallelujah.
Okay. So just think of Matthew chapter 6, where Jesus said, when you pray, pray in this manner. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive them that trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. For, says the next verse, if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father, which is in heaven, forgive you your trespasses. Let's just go to Matthew 6 quickly. Verse 12. This is the prayer you need to pray. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors.
Yeah.
Verse 14. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you your trespasses. Yeah. God says, no matter how much you repent, no matter how much you ask forgiveness, if you do not forgive, you are not forgiven.
Yeah.
If you do not forgive, you are not forgiven. Just think of 1 John chapter 1, verse 7 through 9. It says, if we confess our sin, God is faithful and just, or faithful and righteous, or rightful and just. It depends on which translation you got. If we confess our sin, God is faithful. That if we confess it, He will forgive you. But isn't that funny? That if we confess, God is faithful. But 2 Timothy says, but what about your faithfulness? What about your, when it comes to prayer, the thing that stands in the way is forgiveness. So if my heart, people are not easily, very easily convinced about the fact that they must forgive other people. People can hold grudges for years. But isn't it funny how quickly we can feel condemned because of sins in our life? We pray, Father, and then all our sin running ahead of us. Oh, and we see, I did that, and I missed this, and isn't it funny? But we don't always see what others did to us, but we always see what we did wrong. Now we confess, oh, Jesus. And I ask God, why is it that people confess? Why is it that they don't get free? Because God says, because they don't set free. If you do not set free, sorry, your sins are not forgiven. Of course, we've spoken now for months on the fact that if we confess, we're supposed to be free. Yeah. But why is it that people still haven't got the boldness after they confessed?
Yeah.
So if they confessed and the boldness lack, it means they're not forgiven. But God is faithful to forgive. But God has put it twice in His Word that you must first forgive before God will forgive you. If you know about something, forgive the people. If you don't know about it, don't worry about it.
Right. Come on.
All right? God is faithful and just. So if you know about something, don't walk around with it.
Amen.
Get it out of your system.
Come on.
Okay, so I need to hear from heaven. And I need heaven to hear from me. I need to get answers to my prayers.
Yeah.
So let's go to John chapter 1. Verse 14 in John chapter 1 says, the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Verse 16, and of His fullness have all we received, and grace for grace. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
Now go to one of my favorite chapters, John chapter 8. I think this will help us to get to something here. Just look this way. Grace came by Jesus. Grace came by Jesus Christ. And out of the fullness, I mean, this is not half a grace, it's a fullness of grace. Out of this fullness of grace, we have all received. All of us have received grace upon more grace. Upon more grace. Upon more grace. That's why James 4 tells us we must cleanse our hearts and our hands, because God gives grace upon grace upon grace. Hey, God is so genadig. No matter what you did, He's ready to give more grace and more grace. But He said we all have received grace for grace. Now John chapter 8. Now He says in that same verse 17, the law was given by Moses, but the grace came by Jesus Christ. Okay? Now look at John chapter 8. Jesus went unto the Mount of Olives, and early in the morning He came again into the temple, and all the people came unto Him, and He sat down and taught them. And the scribes and the Pharisees brought unto Him a woman taken in adultery. That's sin. And when they had set her in the midst, they say unto Him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Now Moses and the law. Come on, what we've written on the board. Commanded us that such a one should be stoned. But what sayest thou? Who? Okay. The law of Moses says stoner. But what saith grace? The law of Moses says stone the woman. Kill the woman. Let there be revenge. But grace, what does grace say? And this they said, tempting Him that they might have something to accuse Him. But Jesus stooped down with His finger, wrote on the ground as though He heard them not. So when they continued asking, He lifted up Himself and said unto them, He that is without sin among you, let him cast the first stone at her. And again He stooped down and wrote on the ground. And they which heard it, being convinced by their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning at the eldest, even unto the last. And Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. When Jesus has lifted up Himself and saw none but the woman, He said unto a woman, where are those thine accusers that want to stone you, kill you, have some revenge on you? Woman, where are those thine accusers? Hath no man, look this way, hath no man condemned you? We want to have whatsoever we say. So He says we can have that, but when we say, we must first forgive, because if we don't, we will not be forgiven. Whatsoever we ask, we receive of Him. But we must have no condemnation in our hearts. Condemnation comes and steals our boldness. But if we've got boldness, it means we're not condemned, and then whatsoever we ask. But if we confess, we will be forgiven, but we must also forgive. So the people that stood there with all their grudges said, let's stone, let's kill, let's revenge. Let's have something against this woman that's sinning. Come on. I can't preach, I can just show it. Now in this area, people never feel like that towards other people. But if you go overseas, you get it. You get people that look at people that sin against them and they... Yeah. But South Africans, it's got this beautiful temperament, you know. Nobody ever upsets us. Nobody ever disrupts our peace. Nobody ever steals our joy. I mean, we never get upset in ours. We're always so full of love towards everybody. We just love everybody. I mean, there's nothing in our hearts. But if you do sometimes meet people that want to stone people. So Jesus said, okay, anyone that hasn't got sin, go ahead, kill her. And when they all walked away, Jesus said, were you not condemned? Were you not? Now remember, if our heart condemns us, God is greater than our hearts. He knows how the thing works. But he wants us to come to him in a certain way. Was there no condemnation against you, lady? Now listen. And she said, there's no man here, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Come, church, look this way. So Jesus say, the law of Moses says, come and have something against the woman. Stone her, kill her, revenge her. Jesus said, remember, there you don't get answers. So lady, so you say, what does grace say? Grace says, I do not condemn you.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Go and sin no more.
That's good news. Wow. Wow.
Hallelujah. Shall we go to Ephesians? We can go to Ephesians. Verse number 3, Ephesians chapter number 1. And if you find the book of Ephesians, you get it, chapter number 1, you drop down to verse number 3. When you get to verse number 3, you behold the words and you listen while I read. All right? Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. According as he has chosen us, in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace. Give us revelation. To the praise of the glory of his grace. So he's chosen and predestinated you so that they will go praise out from you to bring glory to the fact that it's grace that brought you where you are. Okay. To the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved, in whom we have redemption through his blood, that is the forgiveness of sin, according to the riches of his grace. He says, you are accepted. If your heart condemns you, you will not get. But now he comes and says, you know, this grace, what this grace is saying is, hey, you are accepted. This acceptance, what does this acceptance say? You have forgiveness of your sins because of his grace.
Glory, glory.
Yes, Lord. Amen.
You see, in life, we learn to be achievers. So when it comes to God, we think we must be achievers. And God doesn't care about your achievements. God cares about the achievements of Jesus on the cross. So when we go to God, when we pray, when we utter, when we go to God, it's not how I perform this week. It's how I accept my acceptance in the beloved, which is the forgiveness of my sins because of his grace. I didn't do anything to be accepted. He did it. I didn't do anything to be forgiven. He did it. Let's go to chapter 2, verse 6. That is the forgiveness of our sins according to the riches of his grace. 1 verse 7. 2 verse 6. And has raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. You are forgiven and you are seated, or supposed to be seated. This grace that says, I do not condemn you. Because condemnation robs you of boldness and you do not get whatsoever you ask. Yeah. So if no condemnation, boldness, and if boldness, whatsoever you ask, you get. Amen. Okay? So, but now the grace has forgiven you. You are forgiven because of grace. And he calls it the riches of his grace. And if I accept the fact that I'm forgiven by his grace, I will be seated on a throne. Oh, last night was so great. In the heavens. If I'm seated on the throne in the heavens right next to Jesus, what will be too difficult to get? I mean, if I'm actually right in the throne room of heaven, seated on the throne with my maker and creator, what will be too difficult if I say, now Jesus, I mean, what will be too difficult? Go to Romans 8. Now remember, we are accepted in the Beloved because of the riches of his grace. He predestinated us by his grace to be accepted in the Beloved, Ephesians 1. Now look at the same words, just in another book. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate. That's what we just read in Ephesians 1. To be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called. And whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, he also glorified. If we are forgiven of all our sins because of the riches of his grace, and that makes us accepted in the Beloved, so we can't do anything, we must just believe the grace where Jesus said to the woman, because I'm the fullness of grace, I cannot condemn you. Just go, you're free. Amen. So if we accept this freedom because of our predestination, he says, if we can take this, this is now Romans 8 verse 29, if we can take this, verse 31 says, what shall we then say of these things? What shall we say of the fact that we have been predestinated to be forgiven of all our sins by the riches of his grace that brings us to a place where we are accepted in the Beloved, that gives us a throne life where we are not condemned? And if I'm not condemned, whatsoever I ask, I will receive. So what shall we say of all these things? I know what we say. I don't know why God doesn't answer me. That's what we say. I've been praying about this thing now for 10 years. I know what we say. I'm asking God, why doesn't he hear me? I know what we say. I've been giving my tithings and I don't get money back. I know what we say. I've been praying about this thing now and why doesn't... I've been asking God to heal me and now I'm worse than I ever was. I know what we say. No, the Bible says, no, we should say something else. What shall we say that we are accepted? Grace has told us we're not condemned. We are forgiven of all our sins. We are accepted in the Beloved because of the riches of his grace. No condemnation. What shall we then say? Come on. If God be for us, who can be against us? Amen. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Yes, hallelujah. Mark 11, whatsoever you ask, whatsoever you say, and when you pray, ask whatsoever, you'll have whatsoever. Yeah. 1 John 3, whatsoever we ask, we receive of him. Yeah. But I'm not going to go back to the condemnation. We've listened to that. Now, grace came by Jesus Christ, and we all received grace upon grace. The law says, no stone and condemn. Grace says, no, I do not condemn because I want them to have boldness to ask whatsoever so that they can have whatsoever. That's why I have forgiven them all their sins because of my grace, to have them seated in heavenly places. So what shall we say of all these things? God did not spare his own son, Jesus Christ, who came to give us the grace. And the grace was received because he died on the cross. How shall he not, now that he's done this, the grace thing, how will he now not give us, please, church, all things? And the word freely is used. All things, whatsoever you ask, whatsoever you say. Do you see it's the same scripture, just in a different story? So why do we lack? Why isn't there all things? Let's go on. Who shall lay any charge
against God's elect?
Against God's elect. God justified you. Yes. We just read it in Ephesians 1. We just read it. Yes. Who is he that condemned?
Come on.
Christ died for you.
Amen.
Yet rather, he's also risen again. He's even at the right hand of God, where you're supposed to be seated with him.
Yes.
Who also maketh intercession for us. That's why he said in John 14, John 12, and John 16, whatsoever you pray, I will ask the Father, and you'll get it. If you ask him my name, you'll get it. So he says, I'm on the throne. So if you accept the fact that you are accepted in the beloved, you'll be at the throne. So the two of us will be sitting together. So just tell me what you want. I'll tell the Father. We'll see that you get all things.
Amen.
All things.
Glory.
Come on.
Wow.
So let's put a few things here. One, I must forgive. Two, I must know I'm forgiven. Is that right? Three, there must be no condemnation, and we see there can't be. If you stick to the rules, no condemnation. If there's no condemnation, I've got boldness. And if I've got boldness, I'll get all things. Puts another thing in. Six, it all happens at the throne where Jesus is seated and you with him. Remember, that's the scriptures we read. He's interceding at the throne where you are seated. So let's go to Hebrews chapter 10. If you had Hebrews 10, just jump to Hebrews 4 as well. And let's read 4 first. Verse 16 for today's teaching. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of trouble. Okay, let's see. If there's no condemnation, and we know the condemnation is there because of unforgiven sins, but if there's no condemnation, we have boldness, and when we have boldness, whatsoever we ask. Now he comes and he says, we can go boldly to the throne, and this throne is called a throne of grace.
Amen.
Remember, it's grace that says, I cannot condemn you.
Yeah.
So we can come boldly to the place where grace is seated and say, come, there's no condemnation, just come.
Right.
Come, if you feel wicked towards your parents because you've done something wrong, you don't go boldly. You send your little brother first. But God sent our elder brother first.
Hallelujah.
Jesus went in first. You know, we say, come, you go ask mother, you go ask mommy. No, you go, you know. Why don't you go? No, go, man, go. Just ask if we can quickly go to the shops. No, you go. Why don't you want to go? Because you know you did something wrong.
Yeah.
Now you haven't got boldness. But if the day was good, you didn't break the cups, You washed the dishes, you made your bed, you know, and you're playing. Then you go, Ma, can we quickly run to the shop? And your mother said, yes, quickly, just watch over the street. You know? Isn't that funny? But when we missed it, no boldness.
Yeah.
You know? And when you come with no boldness, did you get a yes? No, you got a no. Did you get a no because you were ugly? No, because you were not bold.
Yeah.
And the spirit world around you says, there's condemnation, so there's no boldness, so we can't answer.
Yeah.
Ma, can we go to the shop? No. Why not? Because I say so. So we can come boldly to the throne of grace. Grace says we are forgiven. Grace says there's no condemnation. So if there's no condemnation, I've got boldly. Do you see the circle is completed? Yeah. If I go boldly to grace, grace says no condemnation, no condemnation, boldness. So it's a combined thing where I know I'm accepted in the beloved and I'm forgiven of all my sin.
Amen.
Yeah. Hebrews 10. Verse 19. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. Let us draw near with a true heart. In other words, it's not full of condemnation. In full assurance. Come, church, full assurance is I know that what I ask I'm going to get. Having a heart sprinkled from an evil conscience. Evil conscience is the condemning one. And our bodies washed with pure water. So the throne is the holiest. It's there where the glory dwells, where God seats. He's seated. Okay. In Exodus 25, from about verse 21, 22, God said to Moses, Moses, after you've built the holiest, or the holy of holies, I'm finishing. He says, I want you to make an ark. Overlay it with solid gold and call that the mercy seat or the throne of grace. Call it the mercy seat or call it the throne of grace. Can you see? He says, Moses, build an ark and overlay it with solid gold. Call that the mercy seat. And on top of the mercy seat, two cherubims out of beaten gold. And underneath the wings of the cherubims, there where my glory dwells, on the mercy seat, which is called in Hebrews the throne of grace, where God sits. That's where God appeared in the Old Testament, which is a parable or a example of the true Holy of Holies, the throne of God. It says, there, Moses, I will meet with you. There, underneath the wings, I will speak intimately with you. And when you got any complaint or any charge, Moses, come there. Because there, the two of us can speak together. Underneath the wings of the cherubim. So Moses, you must come in there. But now we know, in closing, that the place called there was closed by a thick veil and nobody could enter except the high priest. But we've just read in Hebrews 10, and I didn't read all the verses, verse 20 and 21 says, now the veil is rent, which was the flesh body of Jesus, and now we can go boldly to the holy place. Look here. We can now go boldly. Now this is Romans 8. God did not spare his own son. Therefore, if I accept that fact, that I'm accepted in the beloved, God sent his own son to die to open the veil, then who can bring any charge against you? Who can lay anything against you? Who can condemn you? You are accepted in the beloved because of God's grace. So go boldly to that place that is called there. Because it's there where God says, I can meet intimately with you. So let us go boldly. So to have answered prayers, I need to get to that place where God dwells. Open your Bibles to Romans chapter 8. verse 1. And read it in all the translation you can get your hands on. Now, if you see somebody's got another translation next to you, read that one too. Okay. Look this way. There. There. Is no condemnation. If you read King James, it says, there is therefore now no condemnation. Otherwise, you could have just said, therefore there is no condemnation. Yeah. There is therefore no condemnation. Yeah. Amplified, therefore there is no condemnation. So you can read it in any translation. So they had the temple with the outer court where everybody could come and bring offerings. The inner court where they burnt the stuff. The Holy of Holies where the high priest went in. Jesus became our high priest. Went in once and for all. Paid a final price for all our sin and unrighteousness. The veil is rent. Now let us go boldly. Because if we get there, there is no condemnation. So if you still feel condemned when you pray, you're still not praying there. Full stop, period, exclamation mark. If you still feel condemned when you pray, you're not there. You're still praying in the outer court, or you're still praying in the holy place. You have not yet entered the place where God's throne is. But explain to me another reason why is it that people don't get answers to prayer. Why is it that when you experience that presence, and you've asked, why is it that you see results?
Mm. Come on.
Now, we don't go by the feelings, but the feelings do help.
Yes.
I said, we don't go by the feelings, but they do help.
Yeah.
He says, if we go boldly to the throne of grace, whatsoever we ask, we get.
Yeah.
All things shall be given to us freely if we get there, because there is no condemnation.
Yes,
but now I'm praying out here, where the people are. And I'm bound by ideas of the cross-cut person. And I'm aware of him, I'm aware of her, and I'm aware of him. So I can take his hand and be aware of his pain and be aware of his problem. So I'm standing in the outer court. And I say, oh, Jesus, heal him. Father, in Jesus' name. I say, let's all agree. In Jesus' name, I rebuke this crippling arthritis. I say to this leg, heal. Or I can just take his hand and stand in the Holy of Holies where there is no condemnation. And let that glory flow from the throne through me to him. And say, right, let's throw that crutch away now. Okay, walk. Now, where's the pain? Oh, no, there's no pain now. The pain will not go in the outer court. The pain will not go in our everyday prayer life. The pain will go when we pray in the place that's called there. So, you need to forgive every single person. If you know somebody has done anything against you, forgive them. Just do it. Just do it. And when you're aware of something, forgive it. Don't go look for stuff.
Yeah. Come on.
You know if you feel condemned. And if you keep on confessing and you still feel condemned, then go and look.
Yeah.
Why is it that you keep on feeling condemned? Is it that maybe you're carrying a grudge? But if there's no condemnation, why must I look for something?
Amen.
I'm accepted in the Beloved. I'm forgiven of all my sin. Because of God's grace. And if I accept the grace, I've got boldness.
Amen.
To just walk into his presence and say, Father, and he just says, yes, my son.
Amen. Praise God.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
I've got three sons, they've got no problem to trouble me. To get. They don't come and say, Father, please, in the name of my mother Annelies, will you not please help me? Because I am your child after all. Why do you laugh? We pray like that. Oh, Father, because the scripture says that I am born again by the blood, and because of the fact that I am your child and I am forgiven, and because I am accepted in the beloved, I come boldly now to the throne of grace, and because your word says we shall lay hands on the sick. And oh Father, I stand on your word today, and I come in the name of Jesus that's far above every other name, because you gave us a promise to pray. I now come, oh God, and I want to lay hands on my brother. How do you feel? No, the pain is still there. Let's pray again. Shall we all agree? Father, we come today because your word says where two of you shall agree on anything. Do we not pray like that? Why is it, if that is the way we're supposed to pray, why is it that the sick are not healed? Did Jesus stood in front of the sick and say, because I am sent from above, and because I am the Son of God that was now made the Son of Man, I come in the name of my Father, the Jehovah Lord God Almighty, and I rebuke. Or did he just say, come out and leave him? So there is no condemnation. So there all things are given freely. So there all things that you ask you get. There whatsoever you ask, you receive. There, whatsoever you say, you'll have. Because there is no condemnation. That gives you boldness at the throne of grace. And grace says, I do not condemn. What do you want? Have it.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Wolfdahl Ministries has some exciting news. We're offering you, the viewer, a free teaching on audio cassette. The message entitled Focus Your Eyes deals with Hebrews 12:2. From this teaching by Prophet Quibus, you'll be able to learn why and how to focus on Jesus. So write to the address appearing now on your screen, or even email us. Be sure to quote the catalog number. That's right, free of charge, absolutely free.